This is about what kind of society are you building? What kind of media ecosystem do you have?
Welcome to another of the series of talks at GS. Most of you know me. My name is Anthony Gutman. I co-head our investment banking division in EMEA, but the key is actually my friend Tim Davie, who's sitting here to my left. It's a real pleasure to have Tim here. He's been a great friend of the firm, a great friend of mine, but more importantly, he is the Director General of the BBC, as you all know, the national broadcaster for the UK. Prior to that, Tim was the Chief Executive of BBC Studios, which is the principal commercial subsidiary of the BBC, and was responsible for creating and distributing leading British content around the world, which has become more and more important, as we all know. Huge thank you for joining us. Really
Real
appreciate
pleasure.
It.
No, great to be here.
Maybe we can start with you and the BBC, because you've got this unbelievable role now, super exciting. Mm. But just talk us a bit about your history with the BBC and what it meant to you growing up.
Yeah, I think like a lot of people in the UK, I was brought up in suburban Croydon. And if you actually, we're 100 years old, I should say, this week.
So yeah, we're going to come on to that.
We're going to come on. But it has allowed us a little bit to reflect about what builds you as a person. And that's a bit heavy, but you know, you've got your upbringing, the literature you read, but also there is something around the media you consume. You know, who are the voices you trust? And it's all the old cliches. Some of those, classic BBC news reports. Think about Michael Burke from Ethiopia. Yeah. We were celebrating some of our news reporting that led to Live Aid. This is me. This is, think about those children's programs. And this was a lovely, I dream of those days when there were three TV channels and we had two of them. So there was nothing like a bit of limited distribution to get your numbers up. But sitting there and watching and listening, for those who live in the UK, and apologies for those outside, because it'll all be a bit myopic. But, you know, I remember sitting, listening to that, the chart show on, of an evening, and you used to have that Sunday evening, and you had the recorders where you had to press two buttons to try and record them. Yeah, sorry, I'm showing my
tape cassettes,
and all of this. But this all sounds a bit light, and it's about me. But this is about we'll come to it. What kind of society are you building? What kind of media ecosystem do you have? And for me, the BBC was absolutely set a standard. It showed a world, and this comes to where we are, and I'm sure we're going to come to this in terms of where the media is at the moment and polarization and government control and everything. It absolutely stretched my mind. It got debate going. It was important to the very fabric of who we are. And the media is interesting in that. I worked for PepsiCo for many years. I've worked for a lot of different businesses. But the BBC's purpose absolutely is infused in me from sitting in that house in South Croydon.
Really, ever since you started, you've spoken a lot about the need to deliver value to every person in the UK.
Exactly right.
And we all know that BBC is required to be independent and impartial, and that's constantly challenged. How do you avoid the whole groupthink and ensure that the whole country is represented? And how do you think you're doing on that?
We're doing pretty well on the numbers. I'm very focused on the numbers. Yeah, I think the problem with some of... And this, I'm going to talk about public service organisations, but there are echoes, which is in corporate life, but certainly in public service organisations, there's a sense that, particularly in public service, the key argument often is, we do good work. I'm a good person. I do good work. And what I do is good for democracy, good for the social fabric of Britain, etc. Coming to the BBC as the leader of it, I said, look, that's great, but it's not enough. Intent is not enough. Because our revenue model, although it's kind of weird, is actually quite accountable in its way, because the politicians have an influence, but the license fee, it is a weird thing in the UK. It's beautiful, but if you want to watch live television, then you are forced to pay for a TV license. Yeah? And we get 3.8 billion in. By the way, the sales revenue of the whole BBC is 5.3 billion because you've got 1.6 billion of commercial revenue and growing extremely fast. That's up about 60% in 3 or 4 years. So, and that can go much higher. The 3.78 billion, though, is really about usage. You support the BBC, not as a notion. You support it basically by using it. I know that's like statement of the absolute obvious, but it's not actually that obvious.
Yeah.
If you're, and I think actually to any subscription, it's actually usage that underpins value. So that was the first thing. And then I looked at, okay, so where is that value? And I'm not, I try to keep things simple. Is the value in the BBC, we're not trying to beat Netflix. We're not trying to beat TikTok. We won't. I love them. They're good services. Forget it. But I don't need 100% of your media consumption. I just need to be distinctive and what you, and differentiated. And where we differentiated is we are very well trusted in areas like news, natural history. If you haven't watched Frozen Planet 2 in the UK, it's coming around the world. It's just a must watch. Sorry, I plugged television programs. It's unbelievable. But it's trusted. It's absolutely the process of delivering. We should talk about, we can talk about impartiality and trust. Trust, then I said, you've got to make the cut, so you've got to make high impact content. You've got to have a flawless online offer. So iPlayer in the UK and other things. Well, we've got a lot of work to do in that area. And then get the commercial return to increase the value you get from it. And that's my strategy.
One of the things I wanted to take you on to, because you talk about, you know, impartiality and independence of thought. You know, you and I talked before we came on about what's going on in the world globally. You know, the BBC World Service, whether or not you're a Brit, you know the BBC World Service.
Totally.
And it's an incredible institution. You know, we're going through this period of, you know, disinformation and, you know, attack on democracy everywhere in the world. I mean, give us your perspectives on that.
It's a huge fight and a massive challenge. And we have to decide together as societies and individuals how we're going to sort this out, because the trend lines are terrible. Sorry, I'm generally a half full guy. And there are signs that we can do something, but you're important, everyone's important. So I am on a mission on this. Let me give you some statistics. 73 countries no longer, and actually weirdly it's about 70% plus of the world's population, no longer have a free, truly free press. Yeah? In the latest surveys on-
So 3/4 of the world's population do not have
a fully free press, yeah. The statistics on countries with a free democracy are falling fast in terms of, and I think it's about 22%, looking at the latest reports, were of the world's population are living in what you might term a free democracy. Yeah? It's just, what are we doing on our watch? Yeah? Now, within that, I mean, I'll give you some real life examples. You know, I've had in my tenure, Sarah Rainsford went to Belarus, had a pretty brave, tough, challenging of Lukashenko, and you know, she came back to Moscow. She'd been living there for years, thrown out. Okay, we've just had the Iranian government yesterday taking action against the Persian service. Incredibly brave people reporting on the protests in Iran. Yeah, this is today. This is 2022, for goodness sake. So we are in a fight for this. Just to be clear, we. Independence, impartiality, reporting without fear or favour, and is absolutely the heart of what we do. And by the way, you know, the thing I would say is it requires some incredibly brave individuals. And sometimes I think we are a bit myopic, so we'll be in the midst of UK political crises and stuff like that. I have to say the bit that's humbling to me is I was in Warsaw last week and I sat with our Ukrainian service. Ukrainian service are currently in London, Warsaw, Lviv and Kyiv. And the people in Warsaw, the meeting was all women, one man, and they all had husbands, fathers who were out fighting. They had relocated the family and they are reporting without fear or favour on the Ukrainian service. We've got Russians. Can you imagine the pressure? Russian service. Nice. We've got Steve Rosenberg. I really recommend this. Go and watch his interview with Lavrov. And Lukashenko, he did a half an hour interview with Lukashenko in last November. Stunning. He is in Moscow. Can you imagine the pressure he's under? I mean, I talked to him. It's unbelievable. So look, I care, as you can hear, I care desperately about it. I think it's really, and I said, we don't go for political campaigning, but we are campaigning for the ability Because I just think it's so important to what kind of society you are that you can disagree properly and talk about these things. And I think that's, I think it's really, really important we fight for this.
100 years of the BBC, that's a moment for reflection, obviously.
Big time,
you know,
yeah.
You're sitting running this enormous organisation as you go through this landmark moment. I mean, a few questions. I mean, the first one is, you know, when you think about just in our lifetime, what the competitive environment for the BBC looks like versus 15 years ago, on-demand entertainment, we all know how radically it's disrupted consumption habits. Well, I mean, how do you make the organization competitive in that type of an environment?
It's a huge challenge and a huge shift. And for any legacy broadcast organization, the scale of the change is underestimated normally by the management. So you'll be dealing with traditional media companies. Isn't the story as ever, you know, that the speed of the market and the market change is unforgiving, and people in my job tend to say we're moving fast enough, but we underestimate the pace of change in some ways, and also sometimes we dispense with things too quickly that we thought were linked to the market. So I'm not very clear, but like our values and our quality programming and all those things, there's a hell of a lot on the BBC that I believe, because it's based on human truth, that will transcend any technological shift. And it's understanding what those things are.
Yeah.
And then understanding on the market. The market is not going to cut you a break. This is, I think it's funny in corporations. You know, traditional corporations time and again tend to go bust or, you know, beyond imaginings, they just don't exist because people just went, yeah, but we're kind of Kodak or whatever, yeah? And I like Woolworths, but I didn't shop there, yeah? And if you don't use a service or the market, my kids don't go, look, my dad's director general of the BBC, so I won't watch YouTube tonight. They just go to the content they want, yeah? So the first thing is a really brutal assessment of where the market's going and a downside scenario in terms of how much time. Then I think you then say, okay, there is a scenario here and it's fine where I'm after value. I'm not necessarily after all of your media time. So you've got to understand, I'm not trying to chase every opportunity. I've got to focus. The instinct is, and the BBC's done a bit in the past, is let's just go wider and wider, cover off every base, every community. No. Focus on where we're utterly different. I'm an old-fashioned brand guy. I started at Procter & Gamble. Where are we differentiated?
How do you, you know, in a world where you are being constantly disrupted and you're facing the private sector and you're going up against Netflix and Amazon and Sky and Apple, how do you actually keep attracting the
It's really,
talent.
I mean, we're really battling with it. I mean, I just hired a chief product officer from Just Eat, who's absolutely fantastic. And every one of my top executives could earn a multiple of their salary, bluntly, a multiple. And the simple answer is purpose and culture. And this idea of one life, you've got one life. So they want to do, they're not deciding to sign up till they're 85. Yeah? I'm saying to them, if you get one life being at the center, I mean, I have an amazing job. The tickets are good as well. but I get to see things and I genuinely think I'm doing something important, changing society in a way for the good. I think we have to pay a reasonable salary. Yeah? And you have to have a good package. And I think some of the other benefits, some of the, in terms of, are you at the forefront of whether it be added benefits, Matley, how do you treat people? Yeah. That has to be world-class first. That's almost a hygiene factor now to get good people. Yeah. But we play hard on purpose, you know, and we really, really working on culture. Being very blunt with you, where we've moved on more quickly where that is competition. So if you're in, the other thing we've done, by the way, is it's a bit boring this, but in natural history, they used to be public service employees, the people making Frozen Planet. We took 2,000 people, I did this, out of public service because they could only work for public service and they were being paid a public service salary, which is quite limited. We took them out and put them in commercial. And instead of only being able to make for the BBC, they can now make for everyone. And they're sitting in Bristol and they've grown, they've doubled in size. They're making projects for Apple, they're making, and they can earn more money without costing the UK license fee payer. So well, there's also structural solutions. And people say to me, why did you do that? And I go, simple. To keep the best people. One answer, to keep the best people. And we've successfully done that. What's interesting is news in other areas haven't really had that pressure. But now with a hyper-competitive market, as you've seen, some of our talent go, I don't want to be constrained by digital guidelines or whatever. They go and join LBC, and that's fine. But it is more competitive now, and you constantly think about the right model for that.
No, but also what's interesting about what you say is it's, you know, when you ally the brand of the BBC with a purpose and a mission and a view that you, as you say, you don't have to do it for life, that's a pretty powerful combination.
Exactly. And I think every organisation, I think this idea of what are you here to do, and by the way, I think I have been at places where that purpose seems a bit just kind of the attempt of a corporate comms team to put something on top of something. Do you know what I mean? It doesn't feel, we've seen companies go, no, we're here to change the world. Yeah. Authentic, people smell it straight away. It's got to be authentic. You've got to have, this is what we really believe, and you've got to live that. And I absolutely, by the way, think that can be at the heart of a very commercial, aggressive company, but it has to be authentic.
What's been your, fascinating, what's been the most interesting / enjoyable, though maybe two moments since you started in this job?
Oh, enjoyable. There's a lot of enjoyable moments. I do think it's probably those moments where I've seen live broadcast. Just there's nothing like live broadcasting in my world. So just actually just sitting watching the Today program where you've got an absolute moment of history coming through and you see the team doing it. That is really rewarding. I think in the UK, we really backed women's football.
And, what an incredible job you've done.
I was in Wembley with all those people watching and we had 17 million people on the night watching the women in England do something that the men hadn't done in my lifetime. That's a long and tortuous problem. And it was just complete, and it was joyous. And the thing, I do think there's a sense, and this might resonate with companies or whatever, is in these polarized times, what I would say is we're finding massive engagement with big events. So already, we're bringing in the UK this lovely singing contest, Eurovision. If you're outside Europe, you may speak to someone in Europe, they can convey what the enormity of Eurovision. That's going to Liverpool. It's going to be huge. It's going to be massive. You know why? Because people can come down to the city centre. They can party. And, when you run a race or when you go to a sports event, you can at the end shake hands. You can give a hug to someone. You don't know whether they're a millionaire, an ex-con or both. Yeah? You don't know. But you feel humanity through that. And I actually think the UK's got a really good chance of continuing to keep a strong social, cross-cultural, cross-class fabric that holds us together across all things. And I think that's going to be more and more important. And how companies work in that, how they create diverse workforces that come together, where those you find those commonalities through difference, as it were, if that's a bit of a cliche, but you get the idea, I think it's going to be really important.
Well, that feels like a good place to end, Tim. As a kind of proud UK passport holder and someone who's watched the BBC, ever since I was a young child, I just salute you and commend you and thank you from all of us.
Real pleasure
to
be here.
Thank you for taking the time. It's been a real pleasure to have you here.
Thank you. Brilliant.